Hi, I'm Candy Valentino, and for the last 25 years, I've been building businesses and generating wealth, starting my first business when I was just 19. Since then, I've gone on to build, scale, acquire, and exit businesses, all while investing in real estate and building financial freedom. Now, it's all about you and why we're bringing you the real story behind building businesses and generating wealth here at The Candy Valentino Show. Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Candy Valentino Show. I'm so glad that you're tuning in with me today. I'm so pumped for this episode. So we were talking about what could we really release and talk about as we're getting into the new year. And I thought everybody out there is telling you all the things you need to do. So I wanted to talk about things that you need to ditch. So this is four habits to ditch for a more successful new year. And as we step into this, many people want to make 2024 their best year yet. However, achieving something new, aka a new level of success, will often require you to let go of certain things, certain habits, certain actions, certain thoughts, even certain mindsets that can hold you back. So this was really hard to narrow down. I had about 8 different habits, but I cut it down to 4 for the sake of time. And if you guys find value in this or like it, maybe we'll drop the other episodes or the other 4 in another episode. So here are 4 things that everyone should stop doing now in order to have a more successful year. Number 1, stop making decisions based on emotions. Now, this is a doozy to master. Emotions not only are subjective, but they change rapidly. As we know, what we feel in one moment may not be the same as we feel in the next. And our emotions are easily influenced by other external factors like stress, fatigue, hunger. Have you ever made a rash decision when you were hangry? I know I have. But when you're caught up in the intensity of an emotion, you may act without considering long-term consequences or weighing the alternative options to that decision. Emotions can cloud your judgment. They can introduce bias into decision-making. For example, if you are naturally an anxious person, you may be more inclined to be more cautious with decisions, even if a situation might warrant you taking a calculated risk. Or if you're overly optimistic due to more positive emotion, you may underestimate potential risks and maybe jump into things without fully evaluating them. All of this is why emotion is completely unreliable for making important decisions. So how do we make this better? Well, when you're faced with a decision that stirs any strong emotion, I want to encourage you to practice my pause method. Give yourself time to step back and assess the situation objectively. Avoid making those impulsive choices and instead have discipline. Transitioning from emotion-based decision-making to disciplined, data-driven decision-making is a gradual process that will require practice and self-discipline. Having emotional intelligence, being able to control your emotions, is literally one of the most underutilized skills that you can master, as it's truly a superpower in life. Want to have more discipline? Emotional control. Want to be more resilient when you're faced with life challenges? Emotional control. By mastering this, you can create the mental toughness to remain calm under pressure, to make rational decisions in an emotionally charged situation. And it helps you stay focused on the goal, the here, right now, which reduces your stress. And you know what? I actually don't know anyone in my personal life that has found peace or joy or true happiness that hasn't mastered emotional control. And I am not saying that emotional control is about suppressing your emotions. I'm not saying that. What I am saying is that you can use this to your advantage, to harness energy, using it as a valuable tool for your growth, your success, your finances, your business, and of course, your overall well-being. So how do we develop more mental toughness? How do we create more emotional stability? It's important to follow a decision-making process, and I'm going to give you mine that I referenced. It's coming up in my 3rd book. It's called the Pause Method, and each one of the letters, P-A-U-S-E, stands for something specific. The P, proper time to respond. Take an hour to reply, minimal, and 48 hours if it's a major decision. Don't rush it. You and whoever needs an answer will be okay to sit in silence, so proper time to respond. A, awareness and attention. Be aware of your emotional state as well as any past triggers or patterns that could be clouding this decision. U is utilize data.
gather relevant information, whether research or advice from experts or trusted mentors, get a deeper understanding of the situation with data. The S stands for set clear goals. What are the long-term goals for your life? And how does this decision right now align with that vision? And then have courage to be okay to proceed with whatever you're told. Meaning that if your vision for your life is one way and this one temporary decision right now will not take you closer to that future vision, but it's going to take you further away, be willing to say no. The E stands for emotional regulation. Take 3 long breaths, calm your nervous system, be mindful of your heartbeat, slow your breathing, meditate if you have to, or take your focus somewhere else if you're all hyped up. Look, we are taught in school and often in our family to focus on history, science, and algebra. So unless your parents were fully healed, fully functioning, emotionally stable, and securely attached, we didn't learn any of this. So there is no shame if you tend to overreact or make decisions based on emotions. But that said, you don't have to stay there. Don't let your emotions keep you locked in a place you don't want to be. If you want a different result for your life, you have to make different decisions to have different behaviors, to create different habits, which will give you a different reality for your life. That brings us to number 2. The second habit to drop to have a more successful year is stop being constantly distracted. Look, distractions are a dagger to the heart of your productivity and ultimately your success. Whether it's social media, phone distractions, that iPhone watch, or you're multitasking, these distractions will prevent you from fully focusing on your goals. If you want to have your most successful year yet, establish boundaries on your top 2 resources, time and attention. Distractions can make it virtually impossible to stay focused and productive. In order to overcome this, you have to remove them, at least in bursts. Look, put your phone on silent. I'll show you right now. My phone is on silent. It's upside down. It is like this constantly because unless I want to invite distractions into my day, I'm not going to flip this thing up. Take your phone off your watch. Get a real watch that only tells you time so that you're not constantly distracted by looking at your phone or your watch all the time. And at the very least, consider eliminating those notifications while wearing it. Look, if you can't control yourself on social media, just simply delete the apps. It's a real thing that we have become addicted to distractions. So the only way, like anything that we're addicted to, we have to have boundaries around it and be willing to make a different decision in order to get a different result. Look, we are all a product of our focus. Our focus becomes our decisions. Those decisions become actions. Those actions become habits. Those habits create a reality. So if you want a new reality, it starts with changing your focus. And if you want a framework to use or even help, adopt my chunking method, which is really modeled after the Pomodoro technique. The Pomodoro technique is a time management method that was developed in the 1980s by Francisco, I'm going to butcher his name, Cirillo. And I think it's Italian, so I should actually know how to say it, but I don't. Here's how it works. Number 1, choose a task. Select a very specific task or project that you want to work on. 2, once you have identified that task, set a timer on your phone. Now, the Pomodoro method tells you to set a timer for 25 minutes. This is known as 1 core unit of time in this technique. Step 3 would be to focus on the work. Focus exclusively on that chosen task and that task only during that Pomodoro, the 25 minutes. Avoid any distractions or interruptions and work until the timer rings. The 4th thing to do is then you take a short break. When the Pomodoro ends, take a break for 5 minutes. Stretch, relax, push away from your desk, whatever it is, but do something unrelated to the work that you were doing. And then 5 is you repeat that pattern. So after the break, you return to another Pomodoro of time. You work on that same task, 25 minutes on, 5 minutes, 25 minutes on, 5 minutes. And you do this for 4 cycles before you take a longer break. And then after completing those 4 cycles, which is about 100 minutes of work, you're going to take a little bit of a longer break for 15 to 30 minutes. It just depends if you need more significant rest. But here's a little extra note. I want to encourage you to do this. Let me back up. I don't just do 1 because 25 minutes is not fully enough time for me to focus. I do 2 Pomodoros of time. That's why I call it the chunking method. I take 1 thing I want to work on. I set a timer for 50 minutes and I go hard and focus and just go as far as I need to go with that project for 50 minutes. I will then pause for about 5 minutes, go get a drink of water, go see what Grace is doing, walk around, whatever, wherever I happen to be. And then I will go back in for another 50 minutes. Now, I still do that 4 times, but I do it in increments of 4 hours, because what I've found by doing this is I'm able to be most productive when I do 4 50-minute blocks. And I don't care what happens to be for you. I just want to encourage you to do this. If you want to start with 25 minutes because you're so focused on that phone and all the distractions, start with 25 minutes. You can always increase. But if you've never done this, I'm going to share one other little hack that I've done over the last, I've probably done this for 15 years at least, that if you've never done a digital detox, I want to encourage you to schedule this in the first quarter of 2024. And if you want to hear more about the process and how I do it, I'm happy to share. Let us know in the comments and maybe we'll do another episode. But at the very minimal, even if you don't do a digital detox in the first quarter of the year or the first month of the year, I want you to make sure to just try it, right? Everything that's suggested to you, take what you want, leave the rest. So try it. See if you can get more productive, if you can accomplish more of what you want to do, if you minimize the distractions and reduce the notifications on your phone, disconnect the watch from your notifications, whatever you have to do, I think that it will serve you in a really massive way. All right, back to the 4 habits to ditch for a successful new year. Number 3, we're already almost there, halfway home. Stop caring about what other people think. This is a biggie. Seeking constant validation, worrying about what other people will think, will stop you from achieving your greatest level of success. I'm going to say it again. Constantly seeking validation, worrying about what other people think, will stop you from achieving your greatest level of success. And look, somebody once said to me, somebody that cares about me a lot, Candy, you can cure cancer and someone will still have a problem with how you did it. And that is so true. Back when I was starting the nonprofit, right? Everybody had an opinion. How I should be doing it, how I shouldn't be doing it, why I was doing it, my intentions for doing it, questioning why I was donating my time and my money in a building to this nonprofit. But here's the thing, if you just remember that you can cure cancer and someone will still have a problem with how long it took you, how much money you spent, how much media you did about it, what the result was, how many people you saved or didn't save, all while sitting on their couch, you will never go out and achieve great things. Caring about what other people think, or even taking things personally, can not only be emotionally exhausting, but it's detrimental to your self-esteem, and it will prevent you from being as successful and as happy as you want to be. If you want to increase your overall happiness, remember this. Not everything that happens to you or around you is about you. It's not all a reflection of your worth or your character, or your commitment, or your intelligence, or your intentions. Remember that criticism and negativity from others will always say more about them than it says about you. Now, does this mean that people have to agree with you and cheerlead you and think you're great? No, there are a lot of people I know that I may not agree with their position on a matter or the way they handle themselves or the way they think or teach about business or even the way they show up on social media or even the way they treated me. But hear me out. But none of those things have to do with me. And none of those things will I take personally. None of those things would I ever lash out and type a comment about them on social media. What I do is I simply stop engaging with them. You know, and I heard Tucker Carlson talk about this in an interview, and he said it so brilliantly. I'm just going to quote him here. He said, "Never hand emotional control to people who don't love you. It's like handing a toddler a firearm." Would you do that? You wouldn't. That would be insane. Take all of the emotional energy that you would spend reeling about that hurtful comment or that thing that someone hurt you by saying and focus it on the people in your orbit. And look, this is easier than you think. How do you do this? Keep your circle of people whose opinion that you really care about small and ignore everybody else. That's literally it. Make the decision about who you hand that firearm to, who you give power to. Who you give the power of your focus, your thoughts, your attention, the direction of your life. Look, your focus, your attention, your time is the most valuable currency. It is far more valuable than money. Money, you can get back. Your time, your focus, your energy, you can't make more of that. So guard that, protect it. And for God's sakes, don't give it away to people who don't know you, let alone love and care about you. And look, when you go do something great, in your life, if you go do something different than what's common in your family or in your community or within your friend group, you will ruffle feathers. You will trigger lack in other people. Don't let that change your objective. Don't let that change what it is that you want to do. And I don't know who needs to hear this, but this literally hit me like a Mack truck in the heart. Just because someone is a relative, just because somebody is connected to you by genetics or by blood, does not guarantee them a seat at your table. Being related to you does not give you access to me. And it goes back to what I said before, like, why would I care what someone thinks? Like, honestly, why would you care? Like, let's be rational about this. Most people are going through life either with damage emotionally, physically, mentally, spiritually. They're unhealed. They have unresolved issues. They're unhappy. They're unsuccessful. They can even be miserable in their own existence, often carrying around so much baggage that they can't develop feelings of happiness and joy for themselves, let alone have it for you. There are people that are numbing out on alcohol, drugs, porn, food, gambling, work, all motivated by power and greed and money and attention, and have a desperate need to be loved by people that they don't even know. They can't wait to receive that praise and that love and that validation from strangers. Why? Because maybe they had a broken environment or a damaged childhood, or they haven't healed from some trauma. You know, most people are trying to prove their worth. And often they measure that worthiness by the praise they receive from other people. Even negative feedback can often be recognized as positive to someone who fought their whole life just to be acknowledged. Don't let that be you. When you understand this, not on some intellectual level, but you truly understand how this works on a mental, an emotional, even a spiritual level, you stop caring about other people's opinions. Instead, the only thing you feel, which I encourage you to feel, is empathy. The circle of opinions that I genuinely care about is small, because the number of people that really know me and truly love me, not love me for what I can do for them or how I can help them or what I can provide them, but genuinely love me for me and who I'm not, is a very small circle. And if you value the right things in life, yours will be pretty small too. I had this quote at the end of my book, might not have been at the end of the book, somewhere in the middle of Wealth Habits, that says, care about your dreams more than the opinions of other people. And I think that sums up our third habit to ditch. That brings us to number four, stop negativity in all of its form. Look, whether it's negative people around you, your own negative self-talk, the negative gossip that you share or hear, or the negative actions that you're taking in life, whether they're conscious or unconscious, negativity in so many forms will drain your energy and it will hinder your progress. It's critical to surround yourself with positive influences, to unfollow the negative voices online, to stop listening to or feeding your mind with garbage opinions, and to manage your own inner dialogue and self-talk. Gosh, that's so important. Something that I wish I would have done earlier in life was I was managing all of the environment around me, but I wasn't checking my negative dialogue, whether it was I was not enough, or I wasn't thin enough, or I wasn't pretty enough, or I wasn't smart enough, or I wasn't that person with that connection. What you say to yourself is so critically important too. So if you've managed all of the things externally, make sure you're not missing the internal negativity that you may be sharing with yourself. If you engage in gossip with your coworkers or discussing other people's personal lives or the shortcomings of other people or your company, just stop. Like, recognizing and acknowledging negativity when it arises is so important. Identify those specific people and those situations and the environments that contribute to the negativity, and establish those clear boundaries with people, with situations that consistently bring negativity, and just limit your exposure. Seeking out positive influences, supportive friends, caring environments that will foster a positive atmosphere is so important, and spending time with people who uplift and inspire you is as well. Make sure that you treat yourself, as I said, with self-compassion, with kindness as much as you would share to somebody else. Practice gratitude to focus on the positive aspects of your life. And to have a successful new year, it's really critical to identify any of those habits that are holding you back. When you stop making decisions based on your emotions, when you stop caring about other people's opinions, when you stop being constantly distracted, and when you stop all the negativity in your life, you can pave a way for a whole new level of growth, a whole new level of happiness, of success, of achievement. I promise that all of these things are difficult. It is hard to stop doing things, but I promise you that it's worth it. And if you do these things, you're going to be well on your way to making 2024 your most powerful, your most successful, your most happiest, and your most fulfilling year yet. All right, guys, I hope this brought value to your life in some way. That's all for today's episode. Thanks for tuning in and spending this time with me today. We'll see you next time.